And welcome to all on this beautiful Sunday morning. Again, thank you for the invite to lead worship. As mentioned, for those who are not aware of who I am, my name's Kevin Tabrake. And just to give you a little bit of who's standing up here, for 15 years I was an accountant. And then for 15 years as an ordained pastor in the Christian Reformed Church, having served in Kingston, Ontario and Exeter, Ontario. And I continue to live in Exeter. And God used those two roles to currently lead me into the role at the Christian School Foundation in Hamilton, which your local Christian schools are members of. At the Christian School Foundation, we draw Christian schools and donors from across Canada to expand the influence of Christ in our culture. Like many of you, we want to see Christian education affordable to all and to equip the youth in the name of Christ. And we also equip supporters to be stewardly responding to God's amazing grace. So again, it's good to be here to lead you in worship, and what a blessing it is to gather together as a community, as one body of God's people, bringing praise and glory to our God through this time. The theme of today's service and the message is following Jesus. So I invite you to join me in a responsive call to worship this morning. Or not? No? If not, that's fine. I can read it. Oh, there it is. Teach us your way, O Lord, and we'll follow you in your truth. Whether you turn to the right or to the left, your ears will hear a voice behind you saying, "This is the way, follow in it."
Let us follow the path of God by worshiping our mighty God and by seeking first the kingdom of God.
And as you follow Jesus and seek first his kingdom, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the power and equipping of the Holy Spirit be with you always.
Amen.
Let's continue our worship. Here I am, Lord.
Thank you.
It's in Psalm 5, verses 1 to 2, where we hear these words, where the psalmist cries out, "Give ear to my words, O Lord. Consider my sighing. Listen to my cry for help, my King and my God. For to you I pray." So at this time in service, let's come to our God in a time of confession, bringing our prayers, our sins to God, and hearing about his amazing grace. Lord God, we come before you at this time with our cries for help, just as a psalmist. You provide us the gifts of your word and your Holy Spirit, and so often we fail to do your will and follow your plans for our life. And our actions haven't always been pleasing to you, and we fail to build up your kingdom here on this earth today, often wanting to build our own kingdoms. Our words have been empty and callous, and we neglect to encourage one another. Our thoughts have diverted from holy thinking to negativity and discouragement. And we've been redeemed and reconciled, and yet we fail to be people of reconciliation in this hurting and broken world. So we cry to you for mercy. We're needy people and in need of your forgiveness. We're in need of your amazing grace. We confess our sins before you and before your people. And it's only in the name of Jesus Christ are we able to pray this. Amen. God assures us that our sins have been forgiven. It's in Lord's Day 1 of the Reformed Confession, the Heidelberg Catechism. We read that our only comfort in life and in death is that we're not our own, but we belong body and soul to our faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. Because Jesus paid fully for all our sins with his precious blood. He has set us free from the tyranny of the devil, the power of the devil. And all things must work together for our salvation. And it's by his Holy Spirit that he assures us of eternal life. Even at times when these kind of things might be difficult for us to understand, he still offers us salvation and eternal life and makes us willing and ready from now on to live for him, to follow him. Let's respond in professing our faith by singing the words, "My hope is built on nothing less."
Thank you. We've come to the part of the service where we can give back to God's work in this world. And we have two offerings today. First is for our church here in Blythe and our budget and day-to-day operations and programs that we run here. And second is for Salvation Army Food Bank. And they're offering food to those who are struggling to provide for their families and just giving them a hand up so that they can alleviate some of that stress. So let's pray for our offerings. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning and we want to thank you that you've blessed us so much that we have so much left over to give back to you and your work in this world. And we thank you for this church here in Blythe and help us to be a beacon of light in our community. And also thank you for Salvation Army Food Bank and the work that they do. And thank you for the volunteers. And also please bless the individuals and families using that service as well. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Okay, Sunday school children, you guys know what your age is and who's supposed to come up, so I'm going to invite you forward at this time. I don't know if you usually sit on the front bench there, okay. I'm not about to change that. Come on forward, boys and girls. All right, did you want to sit up there with the rest of your folks? Yeah. Good morning.
Good morning.
All right, a little bit of good morning there. Hey, I see, boys and girls, you got a children's bulletin, and in the children's bulletin, it talks about Jesus calling disciples and disciples following Jesus. So I'm going to be talking throughout the service about how we can follow Jesus, but I want to share with you a little bit what that means. I'm going to assume that most of you have a mom or a dad or both, or grandparents, older siblings, brothers or sisters maybe, and sometimes, as boys and girls, we look to those older folks in our lives, maybe they're teachers at school or Sunday school teachers even, and we look to them and we see how they're living their lives and we follow them and try to just be like them. And so that's important because we look to other people and they guide us and we watch them. But it's also important not only to follow them, but you watch what they're doing, what they're saying, and eventually as you get older, you'll start doing those good habits and saying those good things that the older people that you follow have said and done. Now, where I'm going with this is Jesus calls us to follow him. Now, it's sometimes easier to say, well, I can follow my parent or grandparent or teacher because they're right there. But Jesus says, I'm with you always, and he's given us the Bible. And in the Bible, it tells us stories of Jesus and how he lived his life. Jesus walked around the earth sharing the good news that God loves people, that God saves people, healing people, being kind to people, loving people, serving people. So we have that from the scriptures. So when we follow Jesus, it's not only about saying, yeah, I follow Jesus, that's important, but it's also about doing the things that Jesus wants us to do. Loving one another, being kind, serving people, meaning helping, like what we just did with our money. We are serving people. We're serving the community, sharing what we have. So it's following and acting also, living out what Jesus calls us to live out. So I know I shared a lot of stuff with you boys and girls this morning. If you're confused, you can probably go home today and talk to your parents, and they'll tell you more about it, okay? Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for these boys and girls. Thank you for that they're here and that you've called them here and they want to follow you and live their lives for you. So bless them as they go out to Sunday school and learn more about you and how much you love each of them. Bless them as they go throughout the week following the people that you put before them. And may they not only follow, but may they live according to what you're calling each of the boys and girls to do. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for salvation through Jesus Christ. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I assume you have the cross. Does that mean, like, you take the cross and you lead it? Oh.
I was last week.
That you were last week. Okay, so now do you give it to somebody to? Okay, Zoe gets it. Okay, you're leading everybody out because I have to stay here, so I can't do that. Have a wonderful time. Enjoy. See you later. As mentioned, the theme today is following Jesus, and in a moment we'll be reading from the Gospel of Mark 1. And in this passage, Jesus is at the beginning of his ministry here on this earth. And he's calling disciples to follow him. He calls disciples, and what happens is disciples follow. So today's passage is transformative. It's a transformative moment in the lives of four fishermen, as we will see in a moment, and challenges us. The passage also challenges us as disciples today. So before we read from Mark 1, let's come to God in prayer. God, you're the ultimate disciple maker. You choose people out of your good will, and you equip them and transform them through the power of your Holy Spirit. And you call each of us to be disciples. You call each of us to partner with you in making disciples and being agents of reconciliation in this world. And you give us quite the task and responsibility. So this morning, we read from your word, and we pray that as you speak to us, that we'll listen and discern what it is that you're saying to us in this moment, at this time. Bless the reading and bless the proclamation. Bless the receiving of your word into our minds and into our hearts. Send your Holy Spirit upon us as we spend this time feasting on your message and growing in our relationship with each other and with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Mark 1, verses 14 through 20. I see it's on the screen as well. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. And at once they left their nets and followed him. When Jesus had gone a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat preparing their nets. Without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now, some of you here might like following sports. And I know there's some serious sports fans out there. And being a fan is okay as long as it doesn't get consuming and in the way of other priorities. So let's look at what does a fan do? Well, a fan is simply defined as an enthusiastic admirer. A fan is, let's say, the person who is sitting in the seats at, let's say, a hockey game. The fan's face might be painted, and the person wears their favorite team's jersey. They have the team flag flapping out of their car window as they travel down the highway. I don't know how those things stay on, but they do. The fan may break a sweat only because they're yelling so much at their favorite players, in encouragement perhaps, or angry at the opposing team. Or they could have made the call better than the coach did. But the fan never gets out on the rink or on the field. They know the players, they know the stats, they read the newspaper articles about the team. In fact, fans, those who are sports fans, will not often refer to the team, but we refer to our team. There's ownership. But as a fan, they're never asked to sacrifice a thing, except maybe $500 a seat for a ticket. But that's not a sacrifice, is it? I mean, I deserve the seat, and I'm supporting my favorite team. A fan will keep spending time and money on their favorite team, even when the team hasn't made it to the playoffs since 1967, before I was born, and you know who I'm talking about. Yeah, come on, you Ottawa fans, you know it was 1927 for you. I think you understand the concept of a fan. Well, let's move now from the analogy of sports to church. And it's important that the church doesn't pump out fans. Although sometimes it might seem that way. People are coming in at their convenience, cheering for Jesus, paying the ticket price during the offering, leaving until the next game. See you next week. Sure, they'll complain once in a while about their team, their church, likely their coach, the pastor. But they'll come back as a fan because, after all, it's our church. Well, today's reading from Mark is not talking about fans, but helps us understand what it means to be more than a fan, what it means to follow Jesus. And challenges us to determine, okay, let's ask ourselves if we're a fan of Jesus or are we a follower of Jesus? Are we prepared to not stay in the bleachers and wanting our hearts changed to be open to the Spirit of Jesus to transform our lives, to become that fully committed disciple and follower? So this morning, we're going to look at three phrases that come out of this passage. And the first phrase is, the time has come, from verse 15. The second phrase comes from verse 17, come follow me and I will send you out to fish for people. And then with that phrase, we're going to look at two definitions of the word follow. And then we're going to look at the third phrase from verse 19, preparing their nets. So we got the time has come follow me and I'll send you out to fish for people. And then we're going to look at the phrase preparing their nets. But first, let's look at a little bit of context, what's going on in this passage. It's in the Gospel of Mark, or in this Gospel, rather, Mark basically gets right to the point. He gets to the point of Jesus' ministry. The Gospel needs to be proclaimed. The kingdom of heaven is near, and people are being called to repent and believe. People are reconciled to God through Jesus, and part of repenting is working towards the act of reconciliation with one another. John the Baptist, he was a prophet who came before Jesus to prepare the way for Jesus, and John was preparing people's hearts, and according to the Gospel of John chapter 1, some of the disciples had already heard John's preaching before they became disciples of Jesus. And so they would have known about the coming of Jesus through the prophet John. John was a forerunner and follower of Jesus, and he was handed over to the authorities. John preached against the marriage of King Herod, and because of that, John was thrown into prison. As we read further into Mark 6, we learn that John was killed. He was beheaded. This imprisonment of John foreshadows a difficult life a disciple may have. And there were other disciples of Jesus who, later in their ministry, they were tortured or they were executed. And by stating that John is in prison, Mark is saying that discipleship comes with hardships. Yes, being a fan, sitting in the bleachers, that's easy. But following Jesus is not necessarily easy. So Jesus is preaching the good news of God. And he wasn't only telling people to follow him. He's providing a foundation. He's providing people the story of what God the Father has done through the Son, Jesus Christ. That Jesus has reconciled God to us. That Jesus is calling people to believe the good news of God. That Jesus came to this earth to seek and to save the lost. The people have that good news right before their very eyes. Jesus is in the flesh. So there's a bit of context there, which takes us to the first phrase. As mentioned, Jesus makes a statement in this passage from verse 17. The time has come. The time has come. The kingdom of God has come near. Now, this doesn't mean that the end times were near, but the kingdom of God is being ushered on earth. We're already living the kingdom of God. God is preparing people in this kingdom here on this earth already today. The time has come, and it literally means now. Now is the time to make every moment of our life matter. Now is the moment to be obedient to the will of the Lord. Not later, but now. Now is the time. Jesus has opened his kingdom and calls us to follow his leading. Jesus is providing opportunities to proclaim, to teach, to live out his good news. And he calls people to be completely committed to him now. As verse 20 states, Jesus called without delay. Mark uses those words. Jesus didn't take it to a committee. He didn't wait for a decision. The time had come. He had the opportunity. He took that. Jesus was in sync with God's will. And he knew without delay what he had to do. The key point here with this phrase is that we don't miss opportunities. Don't miss out on opportunities because maybe we spend too much time overanalyzing or overthinking this situation, or because we just got other things to do first. In our lives, in our churches, we can't allow fear to overcome us, because what often occurs when we allow fear to be in the way is missed opportunities. We're called to follow Jesus, and we're called to be obedient to his mission. And so we can't miss out on the opportunities that God puts before us each and every day. We can't miss out on following Jesus and following his will for our lives and for our church. So Jesus seizes the opportunity. The time has come, is that first phrase. John the Baptist is in prison. Jesus begins his ministry, and so he needs to assemble a team of disciples. And he gathers a group of fishermen, and he says, come follow me and fish for people. And that's the second phrase, come follow me and fish for people. Discipleship was a priority in ancient times and in Scripture. And discipleship continues to be a priority in our lives and in our church today. A disciple is willing to learn and continue to learn. Discipleship is a process. It's a journey. And so do we arrive at it 100%? Probably not. But we strive for it. It's sometimes asking tough questions. It's allowing our faith to be challenged. And it's sometimes being okay without having all the answers. A disciple follows a teacher. A disciple learns from the teacher. But the disciple is also committed to the teacher. And in this case, in this passage, we're talking about being committed to Christ. The disciple follows the teacher. The disciple follows the teacher's words and the teacher's actions. The disciple initially sits on the sidelines, so to speak. Maybe it appears initially like a fan, but then the disciple puts that belief and faith into action. What they have been taught, they live out. It's not only about a disciple cheering, "Yes, yes, I believe in Jesus." That would be a fan. But a disciple believes in Jesus, seizes the moment, seizes the opportunity, and puts that belief and faith at work into their lives. And so in this passage, Jesus here has called four disciples. And he first calls Simon Peter and his brother Andrew to follow him. And they're fishing along the shore, as Mark states. And they drop their nets, and they follow Jesus. And then Jesus calls James and John. And they're too fishing, but it makes mention that they're fishing in the boats. And they drop their nets and follow Jesus. So it's important to note that Mark uses two different Greek words that in English are translated into one word, the word follow. But in the Greek language, follow can mean looking ahead. Looking ahead and following who is ahead of you. And then listening and learning and again taking on their actions. But the word follow in this passage also indicates a looking behind. That means you follow someone, it's a new beginning. And when there's a new beginning, there's likely something that has ended. There might be something that you're leaving behind. When you follow your GPS to a new destination, on the one hand, you're anticipating moving forward to that new destination, but then you are leaving another destination behind. The fishermen, in this case, left behind their full-time jobs. Simon and Andrew were casting from shore, so they likely, as mentioned, didn't have a boat. And it doesn't mention that they left anybody else behind. They didn't leave anybody just kind of hanging there without their help. They left their vocations behind, and they followed Jesus. But with James and John, it's specifically noted that they left their father Zebedee in a boat. But Mark also indicates that they left their father with hired men. It seems that Zebedee had a successful fishing business. And so his sons didn't just drop everything and leave him in the lurch. No, they still had employees to assist in the business. You see, God continues to provide. When we follow, we look forward. And yeah, we sometimes leave something behind. And perhaps there's some here who've made a decision to follow Jesus and maybe leave behind a job. Or perhaps some have left behind family. Many immigrants in Canada in the 50s and 60s and even more recently leave behind family. And maybe at times you are called to switch vocations. I know when I look over my life of following Jesus, I love accounting. He called me as an accountant, and yet I left full-time accounting for full-time parish ministry. And he called me into that, and I love full-time parish ministry. But I left that behind and called to continue church ministry in a position where, again, both my previous roles complement my new position. I left something behind, but I also look forward and recognizing that the Lord continues to provide. But maybe there's other things beyond a vocation or family that a follower of Jesus needs to leave behind. Perhaps things like gossip or bitterness or lack of forgiveness or perhaps a self-centeredness, an addiction. Maybe it's a distorted view of the church or who God is. Perhaps there are things that to be left behind as you follow Jesus forward. And as you strive to follow Jesus, think of some of the things that are necessary to leave behind. Come follow me means to look forward to a new beginning, with our teacher, and to look behind at what might or should be ending, keeping in mind God provides and he's in control of the situation, even when things seem so out of control in our lives or in our minds. Jesus took a handful of fishermen typically uneducated folks, mostly looked down upon by others in society, and he prepared them to be disciples, to be followers. Disciples and followers who would change the world and who would fish for people. We said a follower of Jesus learns, but again, that learning must be put into action. A disciple of Jesus makes more disciples. A disciple of Jesus fishes for people, shares the good news of Christ, teaches by words and actions, and partners with Jesus in teaching others to follow Jesus. So how are we doing? How are we doing as individual followers? How are we doing as a church in this area of discipleship? And the third and final phrase comes from verse 19. I like how Mark states that James and John were in the boats preparing their nets. The word preparing is amending their nets. It's establishing their nets for the appropriate condition and use. It's a process of restoration and preparation. And I think Mark intentionally uses this phrase to compare the disciples preparing their nets to partnering with Jesus in preparing people. Jesus prepares hearts. He prepares us. Jesus did not extend the call to gifted, capable, equipped people. He called fishermen. And they no doubt had gifts and strengths. But did they really understand what it meant to fish for people? Did they completely understand what it meant to be fully committed follower of Jesus Christ? Probably not. Remember, it's a process. It's a journey. And Jesus extends the call to people like you and me to be his followers, to be his disciples, to fish for people, to partner with Jesus in building his kingdom here on this earth today. Sometimes making crazy decisions of what's being left behind and who we are following forward. Listen, folks, we may not pass the initial tests of discipleship according to human standards. We may not at all feel or be equipped. We may sense that it's much easier to stay in the stands and be a fan. But again, those who appear less than capable can become successful disciples, because first and foremost, look to who you're following, Jesus Christ. And the Holy Spirit is already working in his people, preparing our hearts and our minds to follow Jesus. And when you're called to follow Jesus, there's an opportunity, but also a willingness to learn more about him and his calling on your life and to live out that calling in the name of Jesus. So we want to strive to be fully committed. And I think there will be times that we will fall into the pattern of being that fan again. There'll be times that we're not at all equipped for the call, or maybe we have so many questions and so few answers. But as we follow Jesus, the equipper, the preparer, he will extend his amazing grace to us, and he will continue to transform each of us into his likeness. A couple of weeks ago, we celebrated Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday. And Jesus wants to prepare our hearts to see and understand what he has done out of love for each of us through his death and through his resurrection. He wants us to understand how much each of us, his followers, mean to him. That he loves the world so much that he gave his life for you. Follow him to the cross, follow him to the grave, to that empty tomb, and see that he has forgiven all your sins at the cross. See that he has given you a new beginning, a new life through the empty tomb and resurrection. Know that he has reconciled God to us, that he is the bridge between God and us. The time has come. Follow Jesus, fish for people, share this great news with others, and live out this great news now, at this moment, not later. So what does it look like to live out this news? Well, I think it's summarized well in well, throughout Scripture, but in the familiar passage of Matthew 25, giving food to the hungry, giving water to the thirsty, inviting the stranger in by showing hospitality, embracing all, clothing the naked, reaching out to the sick and to those in prison, extending mercy and love to those who are vulnerable and have experienced injustices, following Jesus and showing it by our actions of love. Discipleship and striving to be fully committed, it takes obedience to Jesus. And we're called to be people of justice. We're called to be ambassadors of reconciliation. We're called to be disciples and disciple makers. I want to close off with a story. It's a short story of tenor Luciano Pavarotti, where he shares his story of his younger years. His father urged young Pavarotti to work very hard to develop his voice. And he was a professional tenor in his hometown of Modena, Italy, took him as a pupil, and he enrolled in a teacher's college. And on graduating, Pavarotti asked his father, "Shall I be a teacher or shall I be a singer?" He had these two options before him. And his father replied, "Luciano, if you try to sit on two chairs, you will fall between them. For life, you must choose one chair." So Pavarotti chose one chair, and he chose music. But because he did that, it took him another 7 years of study and frustration before he made his first professional appearance. And then it took another 7 years to reach the Metropolitan Opera. And he went on to say, 100% commitment, that's the key. Choose one chair. Jesus shares a similar theme of commitment in the book of Matthew 6, where he says we can't serve two masters. Choose one master and commit to it. We are called to grow as disciples. Choose one master. Choose Jesus Christ and commit to him completely now. As Rick Warren once stated, Jesus loves you just the way you are, but he loves you far too much to let you stay that way. In closing, I'm going to reread parts of this passage. And I'm going to pause where Scripture includes the fishermen's names. And as I pause, as I do this, in your mind, insert your own name into the passage as Jesus is talking to you. So Jesus went into the streets in Blythe and the surrounding communities, proclaiming the good news of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." And as Jesus walked along these streets, he saw and he said, "Come, follow me." And Jesus said, "And I will send you out to fish for people." And at once you left and followed him. When Jesus says, "Come follow me," will you respond like Simon, Andrew, James, and John? Because Jesus is calling you today. Don't miss the opportunity. Don't miss this moment. The time has come to follow him and have your life changed as a committed disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's pray. Holy God, through your word and your spirit, you call us to be your disciples, to follow you. And we recognize that's not always easy. And Lord, if there are some here today or listening online who have not yet taken the opportunity to follow you, work in the hearts of your people. Prepare hearts and extend your call of grace and love to people who will come to know you and follow you in obedience. And for disciples who have already committed their lives to you as disciples, may they walk alongside of one another, encouraging, teaching, and continuing to learn. And Lord, we all fall short in our journey of following you, and we ask that you continue to extend your mercy and your grace to each of us. And may through this we all learn to receive your grace and your forgiveness, and to extend the same to others. Today, may we commit or recommit our lives to you And today, may we take this opportunity to put something behind us and to put you first in our life as our one and only teacher and master. Work in each of us through the power of your Holy Spirit. Transform our minds and our hearts more and more into the likeness of your Son, Jesus Christ. And it's only in his name we pray. Amen. Let's stand to sing together a song of response, Jesus Calls Us O'er the Tumult. Let's stand to sing those words.
Shall we pray? Dear God and Heavenly Father, we come before you today to thank you for the many wonderful blessings you've given us this week. We thank you for the rain and the sunshine that we've experienced this week. We know the farmers are eager to get on the land, and we ask for continued sunshine and pray for their safety on the roads and in the fields. We want to bring forward our search committee and the big task they have in finding our future pastor. We pray that the right candidate comes forward. We want to thank Pastor Kevin for preaching here this morning and the blessing of having guest pastors on a weekly basis. We want to remember all the birthdays this week in our congregation. We ask that they feel your hand on them this week. We bring forward those in our congregation who are suffering with physical and mental illness. We also bring Rennie forward as she continues to heal. We also ask for your hand on Tony as he continues with his cancer treatments. We bring forward our world leaders and the problems that they are dealing with. We ask that your will be done. Grant us the grace to listen to your word and to do your work in this upcoming week. In Jesus' name, amen. Now sing 745.
Thank you.
Today you have heard God's call to follow Jesus and trust that he will guide you and seek Jesus in his kingdom not only today, but all the days of the week, all the days of your life. And as you do, don't be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. And together we say, Amen. Glory be to God the Father.